You know, one of my best friends growing up, we would enact movies that we watched. I'm not going to mention names of who he is, but he's basically a very close friend of mine, and we both actually became pastors. And he's going to be preaching revival for you this year. But we would watch movies, and let's say we would watch The Three Musketeers. Well, when we did, we went out to the shed and got his father's golf clubs and cut off the ends of the golf clubs and began to use swords at one another, because that's what we watched until his dad got home, and then we got a beating. Then we would watch things like Robin Hood, and then we would decide to go out and shoot arrows at one another. It's surprising that we're not even dead, but we are pastors. One thing that we always agreed upon was both of us wanted a Viking's funeral. A Viking's funeral that you see in the movies type of Viking's funeral. What I mean is, one of the newer versions of it comes from How to Train Your Dragon. Take a look at this clip.
May the Valkyries welcome you and lead you through Odin's great battlefield. May they sing your name with love and fury, so that we might hear it rise from the depths of Valhalla and know that you've taken your rightful place at the table of kings. For a great man has fallen, a warrior, a chieftain, a father, a friend.
Sorry, Dad. I'm not the chief that you wanted me to be. And I'm not the peacekeeper I thought I was. I don't know.
An amazing way to celebrate life. At least that's what I thought at a younger age. What an amazing way to go out, so to speak. Blaze a fire. A ceremony, a ritual that only you had, that meant so much. Then I became a pastor, and as I've been enlightened, did you know Hollywood made up this whole Viking's funeral thing? I couldn't believe it. They made it up. It's not real. In reality, those longboats were expensive. For high-ranking warriors, they did bury them in burial mounds and put them on a ship and sailed them off for eternity, so to speak. But they would put a little hole in the boat so that eventually that boat would sink. Then Stephanie, married to Stephanie, I told her about my wishes. I think pleasantly she also added, putting you in a boat and shooting arrows at you is illegal. Plus, who's to say I'm going to hit the boat with an arrow? And I don't want to see your body charcoaled floating back to the shore. It would really take the dignity out of the whole idea, no? So, back to the drawing board I go. I think that is why I wanted to preach on this, because you don't ever hear a sermon on funerals these days. Matter of fact, it has been 50 years since a book has been written on funerals. Isn't that amazing? What theology do we uphold when it comes to funerals? What rituals do we have? What makes us different than all the other funerals? You know, when I was growing up, I was taught many things about how to respect death, how to uphold death. I remember the piety and the honesty and the honor and the nobility and what is right. Nowadays, it's more about the emotions, what is desirable. In the word of that, we have lost a sense of Christ. What I mean by that is, one of the things that I was taught of to respect the dead was, you are to never walk across a grave. Never walk across a grave. And then when I came here to Mount Hermon, we had Easter egg hunts in the cemetery. I was blown away by this. I didn't know what to think or what to do with that. Matter of fact, even as a pastor, you will sometimes see me zigzag across the cemetery, because I still do not want to step on a grave. Do you ever wonder what makes Christian funerals different than other funerals? What should a Christian funeral look like? What makes it good? What else is made up that we see in Hollywood or by culture? And my biggest question, where's the rituals and the creative ideas, like making a ship so that you can sell off for eternity, or do something that Christians do rather than anybody can do? Today, funerals are less formal. We have funeral homes. Funerals are more personalized, more relaxed. Is that a gain or a loss? You know, in Jesus' day, I did some research, and in Jesus' day, and 12 centuries after Jesus, the church took it upon themselves to care for the dead like no other. Matter of fact, that's what made them peculiar people back in Roman society days. Bodies mattered to the Christian community because they clearly mattered to God. This made the neighbors of Christians very perplexed and confused. In Roman society, the bodies of poor people, if left unattended, were dumped into a common pit. Cremation was a Roman society practice, and the poor that could not afford the fuel for cremation, well, they were just buried with the common people in common pits, left alone, because they couldn't do anything with them. Most of the earliest Christians buried according to Jewish customs, but they had their own theology, which allowed them to see and be totally different than the culture that surrounded them. Do you remember Matthew 7, 14 through 45? And it talks about how it used to be in the old days, where if you touched a body, you would be unclean for 7 days. Well, they even took that passage in Matthew 7. I want you to look that up later on in today and see what kind of theology you would get out of that. Because they took that and they said, you know, Jesus said it's not about the external touch or how you touch an unclean body. It's about the inward cleanness that we need to approach, that we need to be about as a community, as a body of Christ. You see, churches had committees to tend to the dead. There was no such thing as funeral homes. Can you imagine that today? we, instead of a stewards committee, we have a committee that tends to the dead. How many of you sign up for that? Amen? But it was an honor, it was a respect back then to be a part of that committee, to dress and to clean the body. However, if someone died back then, they would be buried by sundown. The difference between a Christian funeral and a regular funeral was processional. Isn't that interesting? It was a processional. For a Christian funeral, you would proceed. You would go down the streets. You would have pallbearers. That's where that word came from. Pallbearers to carry the body as the mourners and the family would follow. And they would sing hymns and they would talk about the person that passed on and how they were baptized and what they did in Christ Jesus. Afterwards, the people gathered at the Christian home for a time of condolence and the serving of a meal, when the meal was prepared for the male mourners. Burial rituals from death to entombment was done in a day. However, what was so different from society was the days of mourning. You know, sometimes I think we don't mourn enough. We don't let it go. We are expected to get back into society and into the things of life and go on. But that's what made the Christians different back then. The mourning time lasted between a month to a year in a Christian's home. From a month to a year. Can you believe that? And you see, a failure to bury a body promptly and a failure to do the mourning time was considered a sin and a social shame. Do you remember the story of Lazarus? Turn with me to John 11. In the book of John 11, you see a little hints of this ritual, of the context of how burial and ministry was back then versus how it is and how it's become. If you notice in John 11, it talks about the burial of Lazarus, or the death of Lazarus. And if you look at verse 17, it says this: "Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus was already been in the tomb for 4 days." Do you know what this was called? This was called the time of Shiva. The time of Shiva. Shiva was a week process, 1 week. And in that Shiva, you mourned extensively. And the person or the family that had a deceased could only go from the home to the tomb during the time of Shiva. That's the only time they could go, only place they could go. The rest, or the body of Christ, the community that surrounded those that died, would care for those people for a week. They would bring them food. They would bring them whatever they need. They stayed home or went to the tomb. They stayed home or went to the tomb. For 40 days, they were not allowed to go into society or to work. For 40 days. This was called the time of sackcloth and ashes. This was called the time of mourning. Isn't that amazing how much focus they put on that? 40 days before they could go back into society. If you look at the scriptures, you even see this as well. If you go to verse 31, there's so much in here. I'm going to skip around, but John 11, verse 31, it says this: "When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to go to the tomb and to weep there." Now understand, understand the context of this. This was absurd for her to go after Jesus because she was in the time of Sheba. It could only happen where she would go from the house to the tomb. That's why that passage says they assumed that she was going back to the tomb. Isn't that interesting? But she went after Jesus. There's so much context, theology that you could preach, even if you know the context of how we need to go after Jesus. Our focus is Jesus in a time of death. Amen? It's not in the dead. It's in the Jesus that we go after. Anyway, it goes in and it talks about this, and she goes after Jesus. They assume Mary was going to the tomb, but she went after Jesus. For 4 days, Lazarus laid in the tomb. Now, you know, even in that was also mentioned so that you could see that this was a real resurrection. This was a real resurrection. Because in the time of the Sheba, they truly believed back then that the soul lingered with the body. Soul lingered. Then it would go after the Sheba. And so they have all of this context underneath. And also during this time of mourning, during that time of rest, during that time, people would gather and take care of the family. The family members would also cover their heads to show in society that they are in mourning. And that was also a time for the community to show respect of the dead, to show respect to that family, to show respect to your religion of who you are, not what you do. Also, this was a time for the rest of that year to be lamenting. It was also to receive comfort from your brothers and sisters. But there was one more thing that mourners did, and that is every time they would come together for that year after someone had passed on in their family or their loved one, they would say a special prayer in the synagogues or in the church house or in the homes of Christians. Why would they do this? Why was that? Every time they would have to stay and say a special prayer. This was done to exalt God's great name, to give him thanks for the life shared that was of the deceased, and to remind them that their days are numbered as well. The next part is what I think is so neat, but would probably be so morbid if we had this practice or started this practice back up today. And that is, after 1 year of someone in the Christian, in Christ that died, in 1 year, the oldest son, usually the oldest son, would go back into the tomb and gather the bones of the deceased and then put them in a stone container. They were given explicit and even clinical instruction for this practice. And this was done because of theological importance of the Christian faith and the Christian walk with the body of Christ. People atoned for their sins through the decay of the flesh. And it took a year for that flesh to decay off the bones. The flesh versus the spirit, they would say. And when it was just bones, the person was cleansed from impurities and ready for glorification when Jesus returned. Even if the deceased was entombed as a criminal with the secondary burial of the year of purification, it was considered righteous. It was considered purified. And then that person that was not admitted back into the family burial or the family cemetery or even the family home was able to enter into the resting place of that person's family. What an amazing theology they had. Christians cherished this part of morning ritual, and it brought a great sense of closure as well. The piety, the honesty, the honor, the nobility, what is right was more desirable than pleasures and emotion that rule this day. Think about that. What about today? What about today? What makes our funerals different than the others? Church, we really need to reclaim our theology on this. We really need to come to the funeral place and with death, come with creativity, come with theology and what we do and what we uphold. I know sometimes this is very hard because it's a sudden happening of death. Something suddenly happens. Emotions are flying and things are happening. And we have funeral homes and businesses that take care of those things. But as the body of Christ, as people that are set apart, how can we reclaim this? How can we start being set apart? Churches, where is our theology today in funerals? I know, as the inside joke goes at the funeral homes, most people want Amazing Grace and I Did It My Way to be played at their funeral. We live in a consumeristic world where the funeral homes are a business and they will give the people what they want. But what makes our funerals different than the rest? Don't just follow because that's what you've always heard. But be set apart in the body of Christ. Yes, one would say, well, the difference is we go to heaven with Jesus. But every funeral I've seen, all are pronounced to go to some type of eternal bliss, whether Christian or not. And sometimes atonement is not even mentioned. As the funeral home says, it's what the people want. But what is it that God wants? What is it that God wants us to reclaim with how we care for the dead? How we care for those who mourn? You know, one of my biggest things was you would go and you would have a funeral, and when my dad died, everyone was around me. It was great. But after a week, no one was there. We just go back to the world and expect to be okay. There's got to be a way that we can better this. There's got to be a way that we can reclaim this. Church, we need to wake up. We should be set apart. We should stand on the great continuum of worship with the saints who have gone before us. I know life is confusing and self is being defined in so many different ways these days. Most of the time they are by the consumer choices we have made. Whether it's the college degree that we have, or we are a physician's wife, or we listen to music of Willie Nelson, or we are a race car fan, or we are a Carolina fan, or we are a football fan. We have a great collection of traits, amen? But for us, brothers and sisters, self is identified in our baptism, amen? Self is identified when it begins with baptism. 1 Peter 2:9 says, you are chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of the one who called you out of darkness into great, marvelous light of God. Now, I've seen doves released at funerals and butterflies released. I've seen gathered communities literally grab shovels and bury their own dead. I've seen people shout at funerals, and I've seen people bury silent at funerals. I've seen Dale Earnhardt caskets. I've literally seen a fish casket that looked like a fish. And a wrench casket that looked like a wrench. I've seen flags dropped over caskets. I've even seen monster trucks glued to caskets. I've seen people ride in GT Mustangs of the deceased processional, limos used, motorcycles used, monster trucks used. Cremation of people buried, scattered in the forest, over mountains, or even at the beach. And I'm a young person, kind of. Some of that is cool, and some of that is indifferent to me, but some of that is way too personalized. Church, where is our voice in all of this? For you are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Your identity, yourself, begins with baptism. That is what should be proclaimed. That is what should be proclaimed. The story that is greater than all stories that we could live or be should be proclaimed. And that is the story of the gospel that brings good news of Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection. Amen? You see, those who died in our community are not essentially divorced people or rich or poor or bank presidents or golfers or secretaries or alcoholics or people with autism or any other label that we may bore on them. They are first and foremost saints of the living God, made holy in Jesus Christ. Amen. Those are our people. And we have got to come together and celebrate that kind of life. There's so much more I could say. I might need to do a sermon series on funerals or something. Because you don't bring that up during funeral time. Don't go by the way the culture goes. Go by the way of the Word of God goes. Make it special in Christ Jesus. You know, there's one thing that I've remembered and heard about with a funeral, and I might have to try it out with one of y'all next time. That sounds kind of morbid, but just go along with me here. But when they went to the graveside, they all had communion. You know, back then, communion was a very big part of funerals. But this particular communion was of milk and honey. Now imagine yourself sitting there in the graveside. You're getting ready to bury someone that you love, and you begin to drink milk and eat honey. Why would you do that? But the way they tied it meant so much. The way they tied it was that they were having communion one last time. Not only the communion that Jesus Christ taught us, but the communion of the Old Testament of the milk and honey promised land. That one day we will together be in the promised land drinking milk and honey with one another. How awesome is that? How rememberable is that? How awesome and different that could be. Brothers and sisters, you are the pillar of truth. You're the pillar of truth. It's not up to one person or the culture or the funeral home. It's up to you, the Word of God, the body of Christ, to come together, to celebrate life, to lift one another up, and to truly have a way to remember and to be set apart from all others. If there is one thing we have in common, is that we have lost loved ones. But it's another thing to know that our loved ones has passed on for the better because of the body of Christ. Today, that is my only challenge to you, is to really reclaim what you think about funerals. Actually begin to think about what death really means to the body of Christ. What makes a funeral good? And what makes a funeral lose its way because culture took over? Today, you are the body of Christ. You can make a difference. And it can begin just like it did back in the first century, with burial, with Christians coming together and having a whole new sense of what it truly means to bury the dead, the loved ones, in Christ Jesus. May we stand and sing unto our God this day.
Told my love to me, but I
that God loves you and He has created you for a purpose. Maybe that purpose is for you to reclaim. Maybe that purpose is for you to begin. Even when there is death among us, we can be different. We can make it special. We can make it above all the others. May we do so in Christ Jesus, in one accord, and as the church, so that the world and the people around us will take awe and respect again, not only for love, but for the death in Christ Jesus. This is my prayer to you. Amen.